These have been challenging times, but the body of Christ has proven itself resilient. We've gathered in different ways, in different places, yet stood steadfast as the church. We have found peace in God's promise to never leave us or forsake us. In our separation, we have remained united. In our struggle, we have lived out our faith. In the midst of the unknown, we have leaned on the strength of an all-knowing God. Throughout history, the church has thrived in adversity, and this moment is no different. The power of God is unstoppable, His love unending, His grace unrelenting, His glory undeniable. Today, no matter where we gather, we remain God's people. Our mission has not changed. Our calling has not been altered. And nothing, absolutely nothing, will ever change that. We are the church, and today we stand resilient.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Jubilee Calgary Online. It is so good to have you with us this morning. If you're with us on Facebook or on our website, we're just so glad that you're with us today. Just say hello and let us know that you're here. We're praying for you. We miss you all today. Once again, we're not meeting in house because of the mask and the mandatory mask. But if you have any prayer requests, please send them our way. We want to pray with you. We want to believe God with you. You know, I hope that each and every one of you has someone that you're reaching out to. Just remind you of our U+2. Think of the other people. Just take some time right now to think of all the people that you haven't seen in a while. Reach out to them. Let's maintain that connection. And I'm just going to pray in a minute. We're going to get into the service. We've got a video for you first, but I'm just going to pray. Also, we just want to thank you for your generosity. Once again, if you're giving today, you can text any amount to 84321. You can give online, jubileecalgary.com/give. Or if you want to send e-transfer, you can do that to darlene@jubileecalgary.com. Thank you once again for your generosity. Lord, we just thank you for today. We thank you, God, that you are with us. We thank you for the word that's going to come forth today. Lord, I pray that it brings encouragement, that it brings life, and it brings hope. Lord, for those of us that are at home, Father God, and dealing with certain situations, whether it be fear, whether it be anxiety, Lord, I just pray that you would just bring your peace into the room, Lord. For those of us that, God, are dealing with sickness or pain, God, I thank you that right now your Holy Spirit would just bring healing into our bodies, Lord. Thank you for a touch of your Holy Spirit that just brings life wherever we're at. And we just thank you for this, God. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll be right back.
I see heaven invading this place. I see angels praising your holy name, and I sing praise, I sing praises. I give you honor, worthy Jesus. I see glory falling in this place. I see hope restored, the healing of all disease, and I sing praises, I sing praises. I give you honor, worthy Jesus. We give you praise and all of the honor. You are our God, one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God. We give you praise and all of the honor. I see heaven invading invading this place. I see hope restored, praising your holy name. And I sing praises, I sing praises. I give you one worthy Jesus. I see glory falling in this place. I see hope restored, the healing of all disease. I sing praise, I sing praise. I give you honor, worthy Jesus. We give you praise and all of the honor. You are a God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God. We give you praise and all of the honor. You are a God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God. And all of the glory. And all give life, you are love, Every heart that is broken, you give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart. Come on, church, sing it with us.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will say. Great are you,
it's our time. We must rise up and no longer disparage. It's our time, church, to honor our heritage. We have a Savior. He gave it all on the cross. We stand beside martyrs who counted nothing as loss. They took God's mysteries, opened them up for us. Stephen, John the Baptist, Bonhoeffer, Jan Hus. Surrounded by a cloud of witnesses above, it's now our turn to model his unending love. Our mission is one we cannot confuse, nor muddy up with some trite excuse. You say you're not well-versed, ready, or able. I think Moses even tried to use that fable. The time we have, it's now more urgent. If we should hear, well done, faithful servant. Yeah, church, it's our time. It's our time to confess the ways we're mangled, the sins and selfishness that have us entangled. Lust, greed, and pride, their path leads to the grave. Yet we return to our sins as if we're a slave. Can we survive in this putrid Dead Sea? I quote Paul, may it never be. So let's cast aside our individual leprosy and begin to leave a biblical legacy. There's a glorious prize awaiting to be won, and the way to win is to start to run. Let's lace them up and fight the good fight, become to the world both salt and light. Our life on earth is merely a vapor. Our chapter must move from pen to paper. So church, let's get to writing because it's our time. It's our time, church. We have what it takes to help the world from its slumber awake. To Jesus, we are his beautiful bride. Whom shall we fear with him on our side? We have each other. We are not alone. It's iron to iron in the combat zone. There's a promise of life full of adventure. As long as we give both talents and treasure, the workers are few, the harvest is plenty, with so many lives running on empty. Scores of people trying to cope, they've come to the end of their proverbial rope. Young eyes are wandering, looking for direction. Make sure we point them to his resurrection. The clock's ticking, we're on our dime. Hey church, rise up! It's our time.
Church, it is our time. I know these times that we're in right now just seem so impossible, but the fact is, if there's any time for the church to shine, it is right now. If we believe that Jesus Christ is our hope of glory, if we believe in the hope of the cross, and the resurrection, what God has done, it doesn't matter what's going on out there. We have, as the church, remember the church isn't the building, the church is you. It's those that call in the name of Jesus Christ. We have this opportunity, we have this time where we can be on our knees praying, where we can be asking God for the wisdom to reach out, to bring hope and to bring life and to bring healing. We don't have to fear, we don't have to walk in fear, we don't have to walk in anxiety, but we can trust God and his Holy Spirit in us as the church to bring about the kingdom of heaven onto this earth. And you know, I was just reading in Ephesians 5 the other day, and here's what it says. It says, pay careful attention then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise. And then it says, redeem the time because the days are evil. Now that word redeem means to buy back. In other words, there's going to be a cost to it, but God calls us as those who believe in him to actually make the most of every opportunity. That's another translation. Not just redeeming the time, but making the most of these days. Now, when you think of the days as evil, some of you might have, you know, in your mind this picture of a Saturday morning cartoon with, you know, some evil villain, you know, and what have you. But here's what that word evil means. Evil is a spirit that would try to come to bring toil, to bring pain. It's a malicious spirit. It's something that wants to come in and it's in to bring labor, to bring any type of annoyance or peril in our life. And we live in a day right now where there's a lot of stuff going on, where there's pain, where there's toil, where there's peril, where there's a lot of annoyances going on, where there's a lot of malice, a lot of hate. And God says, be wise. That we as the church, we need to be wise and we need to redeem this time. This is our time. And so my question to us as we talk today about what the Word of God is saying, encouraging us, what are we doing to redeem the time? Are we stuck in our own world? Are we stuck in our own place? There's something. The church, we as believers should be set apart. There's something that should be different about us because of the fact that we believe in the risen Savior. And we can bring hope and deliverance to a world that's in need. And what are we doing? How are we redeeming the time? How are we walking in wisdom? And it goes on and it says in Ephesians 5, verse 7, he says, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. This is an incredible time for us to be on our knees asking God, Lord, what is your will for this? How is it, God, that you're going to move? And what is it that you're going to do right now in this time? Because when we see impossibility, God sees possibility. And God wants to show us, as his children, he wants to show us the possibilities that exist in this world of impossibility. But it says, understand what the will of the Lord is. And it says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to reckless indiscretion. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Now, you know, it's interesting that he talks about being drunk on wine. Obviously, that was an issue, but that wasn't the main point that's being made here. What the point he's saying is, you know what? A lot of us as Christians have come to a point in our life where we've used the freedom of Christ for superficial things. You know, some of us are more excited about the fact that, hey, you know what? I can do that, and that doesn't matter. That's, you know, I have this freedom. And Jesus is saying, you know what? Don't sit there and rejoice in all these superficial freedoms. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's the ultimate freedom that we have. So instead of being drunk with wine, or instead of looking at all these things that we call, it's like, oh, you know what? God doesn't care about that. That doesn't matter to God. You know, I'm free. That's religion. No, that's religion. It's just bondage. It's like, what God is trying to say here is, you know what? There's things that we spend our time thinking about. Oh, you know, that's awesome that Jesus has given us that freedom. But he's really saying, are you filled with the Holy Spirit? Have you surrendered your life to the Spirit's wisdom and the Spirit moving in and out of you? All these other things are insignificant. Some of the freedoms that we rejoice and celebrate, you know, in Western culture as, well, this is what God set me free. He set me to this freedom. It's what's funny is we miss the point of that relationship with the Holy Spirit. And that's ultimately where God is trying to drive us to. This is how we redeem the time, is in relationship with the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you have place, you have lordship in my life to will and to do of whatever it is that God wants to do in me. And so Ephesians 5 tells us to redeem that time. You know, the other day I was in between meetings and so I just wanted to get a space, about 20 minutes in between meetings. So I found this place in a park and I sat down, and I'd received some news that was a little bit disappointing. You know, I'd received a call from someone and I knew that they were really disappointed in what was happening. And so I could feel in that moment the weariness of this, the evil behind this sort of this, it was just such a painful thing. And it was so disappointing. And so I had to sit somewhere, and I just got before God, and I was sitting on this bench in the park, and as I sat there and as I was praying and just trying to release this to the Lord, because I felt this disappointment beginning to take over a lot of my, you know, my disposition, and I thought, God, I'm gonna give this to you. And as I was, I could hear the birds, and there's a creek in front of me about 20 yards away, and then a little bit farther in the distance, there were some trees, and I looked up, and as I looked up, I saw this hawk. This hawk was flying towards these trees. And then out of nowhere comes, I don't know if it was a sparrow or a robin, what kind of bird it was, I don't know. But it just came, and it was like World War II, man. It was like, it was just kamikaze towards this hawk. It was just a small little bird, and this big, you know, this big hawk, and all of a sudden, at least the next 5 minutes, you could see this hawk trying to move towards these trees, and this little sparrow, whatever it was just dive bombing, and it was so awesome to see this small bird that was dominating this thing. It was like Top Gun, this dog fighting, you know, and eventually the hawk flew off. Now, I don't know. I don't know why there wasn't other birds that came to help the little one. You know, if it was, but it was all by itself. And whatever it was defending was worth it. Whatever it was defending was worth it, taking on this larger predator. And I think of us in our lives, and I think, you know, as Christians in this time, we need to come to the understanding that this little bird had, that whatever it was given, whatever, I don't know what it was protecting, probably it's a nest, what have you. But we as Christians need to understand that we've been given a purpose that is worth defending. That in this time and in this season, it is so vital that we are tenacious, that we stand up, and that we do not let our steadfastness, that we do not let anyone take the promise of the Holy Spirit from us, the promise of an abundant life that God has given us in the middle of all this chaos, that this is our time to stand up. And just like that bird was willing to fight and to go and take on this predator, this enemy, this evil that was lurking, we need to stand up and say, you know what? It doesn't matter what my suffering is. I will step out and realize that God has anointed me. He's anointed you for this time to bring hope and to bring life and to bring people to the cross of Jesus Christ. Because at the end of the day, God is trying to call people to his goodness, and we have the capacity to do that. But you know what? That bird was willing to give its life because it had purpose. And this is something that we need to understand, is that there is an enemy, there is evil, there is something out there in these days that's trying to take and challenge the purpose that God has given you and I. And our purpose goes beyond our jobs. Our purpose goes beyond making money. Our purpose goes beyond our comfort. Our purpose goes beyond our convenience. The purpose that God has given us is the same one that he gave his son, Jesus Christ, to destroy the works of the enemy, to bring life where there's no life, to bring hope where there's hopelessness. And so in 1 Peter 5, it talks a little bit about being humble, that submitting yourself to God, that God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And then it goes on and says this in verse 8, it says, cast all your cares on him because he cares for you. And that's a good foundation for us to realize the purpose in our life and whatever challenges that we face and whatever this day brings, to remind ourselves that we have to cast our cares on him, that humility is actually casting our cares on him. When we hold our cares, it's pride. And so it says, cast your cares on him. Why? Because he cares for you. And then it goes on and it says, be sober-minded and to be alert, just like we read in Ephesians about being awake. Know what's going on. Know the mind of the Lord. It says, be alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm and strong in your faith. You know, I find this really significant, because if you understand how lions hunt, it's usually the females that do the hunting, and then the male comes along after and finishes devouring the spoils, like the victor who basically comes in on this great meal. But here we see that the enemy comes, and it says like a singular lion, seeking whom he can devour, which tells me that if it's anything to do with how lions hunt, it would mean that there's already something that's happened in the prey that where it is in a vulnerable position for that male lion to come and to devour it, which means it's already down. It's already been taken down. And it's so important in our day. It's important for us as Christians to evaluate in our life, what are the things that are putting us in a place of vulnerability to be devoured? It means we're already down. And so, you know, the females, when they hunt, you know what they're looking for? They're looking for people who are isolated, or they're looking for prey that's isolated. They're looking for prey that's slothful and tired. It's interesting, because the word evil actually refers to laziness as well. It's interesting that God considers laziness evil. But here, these lionesses, they come out and they're looking for one that's lagging behind, one who's unaware, not paying attention. They're looking for one that may be already injured or behind, just alone. And you know, the enemy, he does the same thing. And what happens is we can easily, as Christians, isolate ourselves. Pride, arrogance, being alone, standing off, not coming together and having a faith that's just about us, that our faith is egotistic, it's self-centered, you know, and that makes us vulnerable to the attack of the enemy. And it says here, it says, be sober-minded and alert because your enemy is looking to devour you. He's looking to devour the word of God that you've received. He's looking to destroy you and to bring you down. And this is the time for the church to rise up. We know better. If we've heard the word of God and we've received the promise of Jesus, we understand the resurrection. We know better than to sit back. We know better than to let fear become the very thing that manipulates us and controls us. We know better than to let sin and evil dictate to us what our life is supposed to be. And so this is a day, this is where we need to redeem the time, where we look for the opportunities to bring Christ into every situation, especially during this COVID time when there's fear, where it's rampant, where there's betrayal, where there's malice, where there's anger, where there's a lot of division going on. It's amazing to me how many families right now are divided just on certain topics of just COVID and how to handle it. That is the enemy's strategy, to bring in division. We need to stand up and say, wait a minute, what is the will of God? Not my will, but what is God's will? What is God saying to us? Instead of just throwing around our opinions, we need to get on our knees and pray and invite the Holy Spirit and be filled with the Holy Spirit so that we can walk as wise men, not as unwise. You know, this is God's desire for us. And humility is so important in this season. If we're going to make the most of this time, humility is so important. Just like in 1 Peter where it talked about, clothe yourselves in humility. Why is humility so important? Because humility is the doorway to repentance, and repentance is the access to grace. The grace that I receive and that I walk in my life, it is completely based on the humility, the coming under God's word, God's way of doing things, his kingdom, not my way, but his way, his will be done. And so when I don't want God's way, I'm not being humble. Repentance is changing my mindset to think the way God thinks. And you know, it's interesting because a lot of times we associate love and grace and we say they're the same thing. Nothing will separate you from the love of God, absolutely nothing. But the grace of God, it says we can nullify the grace of God when we don't repent. We're not walking in humility before God. It is time for the church to rise up. And how do we do that? We become humble before God. We say, God, it's not about my will, it's about your will. You know, 1 Peter 5, it closes with this. It says, and the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ Jesus, after you've suffered for a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. You want to walk through COVID? The church wants to walk through COVID and come out strong and firm and steadfast? We need the grace of God. And how do we do that? By becoming humble before him, by saying, God, if there's anything in me that is not of you, if there's any evil way in me, if there's anything in me that is my mindset, not your set, God, I lay it before you and I repent of that. Holiness is being separated. It's being set apart. Now we're in the world. We're still living in this world. So we don't just go hide somewhere in our homes. But no, we grab the grace of God, and we hold on to it, and we take that anointing, we take that grace, and we bring it to the world. So they see the love that we have for each other, that it's real, and they see the hope that we have, that it's real, and they see the grace of God, the ability and the capacity that even in the midst of our suffering, we will not despair. We will not let go of the hope of God's goodness. And in this, we say, God, would you use us? We are your children. We're the children of light. And so we stand firm and steadfast, and we do not let go of our hope. I want to close with just some points from Ephesians chapter 5, 1. So if you go back to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1, here's what it says. It's talking about we as the church, those of us who believe in God, and we profess to be Christians. If there's a legitimate profession to be believed, here's some things that follow. Because you know what? Wherever there's truth, there's got to be fruit. And if this fruit's not in our lives, if this is not the way that we're going in the walk that we're walking, then it's time for us to evaluate and say, okay, God, I do want to be able to make a difference. What is it in me that needs to go so you can fill that space? And Ephesians 5:1 says this, number one, be imitators of Christ. Be imitators of Christ. That in and of itself is a completely different message. That in and of itself is a lifelong journey. That in and of itself, that following Christ and becoming like him, be imitators of Christ. And so one thing that we do when we walk as Christians, we say, does this behavior imitate Christ? This word, this action, this deed, would this be an imitation of Christ? Second thing it says is walk in love like Christ did and give yourself for one another. And it goes on, it says, no hint of sexual immorality, impurity, or greed should be found amongst you. Not one hint of it. Greed is this idea that I've got to get more and I've got to take, take, take. We know what impurity is. It's anything that's not pure. You know, it's interesting because the Word of God says that the wisdom of God is first of all pure. So God, we want your wisdom, not our wisdom. We don't want to do things based on how we think they should be done. God, we want to do them based on how you think they should be done. No hint of sexual immorality. And then it goes on, it says, no foolish talk, no obscenity, no crude joking, no poor character. These are things that the Word of God is calling us to. This is the holiness. It goes on, it says, any of these things, if there's any of these things, says there will be no inheritance in the kingdom of heaven. This is God saying this. There's no inheritance. And so that bird that was defending that purpose, that nest, what are we doing in our lives to protect the inheritance that God has for us? Because here it's telling us that if we are imitators of God, we walk in love. And we avoid these things and we rely on the grace of God to avoid the foolish talk, the obscenity, the crude joking, the poor character. When we do that, it says that we are working towards an inheritance, that God has something that he wants us to inherit and to live and to draw from in this life. And it says that we don't inherit those things. We don't see the kingdom of heaven revealed in the way that God wants to see it revealed in our lives. When these things here are given place in our life, this is why we have to redeem the time. This is why we have to make the most of every opportunity, making sure that we're imitators of Christ, that we don't give place for all these other things. Then it goes on and says, give thanksgiving. It says, do not be deceived by empty words, and it says, test and prove what the will of the Lord is. Every day of our lives as Christians, we have an opportunity to prove and to test the will of God. Do we know what the will of God is? Well, it says that we know what the will of God is when we're transformed by the renewing of our mind and not conformed to the world. That's when we begin to prove what the will of God is. You know what? You cannot transform something in your life that is conformed to the world. If you're conforming to something, if you're giving place to something, it will never be transformed. You cannot transform the things in your life that are conformed to something else. So the question is, as Christians, if this is our time, if God is calling us to rise up and to be his voice and to be his imitators and to bring the truth and the hope and the deliverance of the gospel to this world, the question is, what am I conformed to? Because those things will not allow me to be transformed. And God calls us to transformation. He calls us to be disciples and to follow him and to bring other people along with us to the understanding of who he is, to know that he's a father that loves us. And in his love, he gives us the tools and the grace that we need to live to the standard of life that he's called us to. Test and prove what the will of the Lord is. I want to close with this thought. When we go beyond just knowing what happened at the cross, because a lot of us can tell the story, yeah, Jesus died on the cross. But when we understand and realize why, when we fully understand and grasp in us why he died for us, why the resurrection is so valuable, and we begin to protect that like that bird protected the nest, with tenacity and with a fight and with a fervor, we protect the inheritance of what Jesus Christ did for us and say, there is nothing that will stop me. Like Paul says, I will experience the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the power of it. When we push forward to that, the church will never be the same. This is what God is calling us to. This is our time. It's our time to rise up, to step into the calling of the Holy Spirit, to know the Holy Spirit, to know the will of God. But when we realize why the cross happened, when we get to the why, not just the what, we begin to dig deeper into our purpose. There's a purpose in your life that goes beyond the surface of our comfort and our convenience. The kingdom of heaven is in us. The kingdom of God is in us. And when we look at Christ, we imitate him. Look at what Christ did on this earth, because every single one of us, without excuse, is called to be Christ to this world. Every single one of us. Just like the video said, Moses tried to give an excuse and God said, that's not gonna fly. We have no more excuses. We have no more excuses. So what is it that God's calling us to? It's the purpose of the Son of God to bring reconciliation and life and hope to the world, knowing that, you know what, our sins are forgiven through Jesus Christ and we can live a life and a standard of living that goes beyond the evil of the day. And in that, we experience the fullness of his grace. And so today, I want to pray for each and every one of you. You know, COVID has put some of us to sleep. COVID has put some of us in a place where we're no longer alert. The summertime has put us in place where it has, you know, and thank God for the beautiful weather that we've had. And yes, we enjoy the outdoors and you should. And I hope each and every one of you has had an opportunity to sit outside and just soak in the blessing of the weather that we've had lately. But I'll tell you what, that should never take the place of the call that God has on us as Christians, that we should never sit down and be lazy. We never quit. We don't stop believing. We don't stop being steadfast. We don't lose our hope. We don't lose our faith. So God, would you reveal to us what your will is, and may we redeem the time. Lord, I just pray for all those that are watching today. Lord, I pray if there's a weariness and a heaviness upon them, God, I thank you that right now they would just draw from the Spirit of God. Lord, we just pray that you would fill their hearts with hope. God, I pray that we'd not grow weary in well-doing, but we would be the church that we'd rise up because this is our time. And Lord, may we redeem the time. May we make the most of this time that we have and not be so isolated and introverted that we don't reach out to you and reach out to others. And I thank you, Lord, for this now in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for watching today. We're praying for you. We love you. If you need anything, once again, please reach out. And we hope to see you soon. Stay healthy, stay safe, be wise, and redeem the time.